I'm going to take you on an historical journey and give you puzzle pieces. Your goal is to piece together the structure of benzene as early as you possibly can, using only the information that I give you. If all you want is to see me draw the structure of benzene, then skip ahead to the end. But if you truly want to understand delocalized electrons and resonance structures, then stick with me for this entire journey. Let's go back in time to just before the year 1865. The United States is in turmoil, so let's hop across the pond to my ancestral homeland of Europe for purposes of this story. I want to start by telling you the things that chemists knew about benzene at this point in time. So first, benzene has a molecular formula of C6H6. Why is that significant? Six hydrogens is an extremely low number of hydrogens for a compound with six carbons. So I have line structures of four different compounds drawn here, each with six carbons, so that we can look at their number of hydrogens. I do have a video about line structures if you need help figuring out what these mean. But first is hexane. This is six carbons in a chain. This is an example of an acyclic and saturated hydrocarbon. So by acyclic, I mean there is no ring structure. By saturated, I mean there are no multiple bonds. This type of molecule, an acyclic saturated compound, is going to be holding on to the largest possible number of hydrogens that it can. So generic molecular formula for an acyclic saturated hydrocarbon is CnH2n+2. N is a variable for the number of carbons. So in this case, N equals 6. If N is 6, 2n plus 2 is 14. So that gives us a molecular formula of C6H14. So each carbon likes to make a total of four bonds. The first carbon is bonded to one other carbon, so it's bonded to three hydrogens. Same with the last carbon, three hydrogens. These carbons in the center, they are all bonded to two other carbons, so they each have two hydrogens on them. In other words, each carbon has at least two hydrogens, but the first and last at the end of a chain have an extra hydrogen each, so two more hydrogens. Now, every time I add some feature, whether it's a cyclic structure or a multiple bond, I end up losing two hydrogens. So this is hexane. Let's convert it to cyclohexane. So cyclohexane has six carbons in a ring. In order to do this, I need to remove a hydrogen from my first carbon. I need to remove a hydrogen from my last carbon. So I took away two hydrogens. That is because carbon likes to make a total of four bonds. If I want to form a bond between my first and last carbon, they each need to lose a hydrogen. So cyclohexane has two fewer hydrogens than hexane, so C6H12. Now, multiple bonds are another way that we can lose hydrogens. So carbons like to have four bonds. This carbon, it is double bonded to another carbon, so it only has two hydrogens, where this carbon had three. This second carbon, it's double bonded to one carbon, single bonded to another. That's three bonds. It only has one hydrogen. So this compound versus this compound, the difference is we've added a double bond, but we lost two hydrogens here as well, so C6H12. Now this compound, we have a triple bond. Think of this as adding another bond. We lost two more hydrogens. So carbon one is triple bonded to another carbon, so it has one hydrogen. Carbon two, triple bonded to one carbon, single bonded to another. It does not have any hydrogens. So a saturated compound versus a triple bond, we actually lost four hydrogens. So when you see C6H6, and when you know that an acyclic saturated compound is C6H14, that means there are some structural features that caused us to lose eight hydrogens. Now, every time you saw a ring structure, you lost two hydrogens. Every time you added an additional bond, you lost two hydrogens. So for the most part, structural changes cause you to lose hydrogens in pairs. So if we are missing 8 hydrogens, we can assume that there are 4 structural features, each of which caused us to lose 2 hydrogens. Whether they are rings or multiple bonds, we don't know. But one way I could word this is we can say benzene has a degree of unsaturation of 4. It has a total of 4 rings, multiple bonds, something like that. The second thing we know is benzene is unusually stable. Best of luck figuring out why that's important to the structure. The third thing we know is benzene does not undergo electrophilic addition reactions that are characteristic of alkenes. So this is an example of an alkene. An alkene is any compound that contains at least one carbon-carbon double bond. And alkenes undergo electrophilic addition reactions. So in this reaction, I am adding something across the double bond. In this particular example, it's this hydrobromic acid, HBr. But what happens in this electrophilic addition reaction is that this carbon-carbon double bond breaks into a carbon-carbon single bond. These two carbons are still going to be bonded to the hydrogens that they originally had on them, but we are going to add the hydrobromic acid across the double bond. So one carbon is going to be bonded to this hydrogen, other carbon's going to be bonded to this bromine. So this was an electrophilic addition reaction. This happens whenever you have a carbon-carbon double bond anywhere in the compound. Benzene does not undergo this type of reaction. That implies that benzene does not contain any carbon-carbon double bonds. The fourth thing that we know right now about benzene is when a halogen is substituted for one hydrogen, only one product is obtained. When the product undergoes a second substitution, 3 products are obtained. So halogen, that's anything in group 7A of the periodic table. So fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, and so on. It doesn't matter which one we pick here, so I just am using the variable X. But we're starting off with benzene, C6H6. And we are picking one of those hydrogens, any one of them, just choose randomly, replace it with a halogen, and we only get one product. This tells us that those 6 hydrogens are equivalent. They're the same. Whatever the structure of benzene is, it's symmetrical in some way that causes all 6 hydrogens to be the same. When this substitution product undergoes a second substitution, we get 3 products. Let's talk a little bit more about equivalent hydrogens to try to piece together what this means. Let's look at these compounds. First is ethane. This is 2 carbons in a chain and a total of 6 hydrogens. If we replace any one of these 6 hydrogens with a halogen, there is only one possible product. In that product, one of the carbons has 2 hydrogens and a halogen, the other carbon has 3 hydrogens. It does not matter whether it was the left or the right carbon to begin with. You can just look at the molecule from the other orientation. There is only one product. However, if you take this product and replace a second hydrogen with a second halogen, there are 2 possible products to that reaction. The 2 halogens could end up on the same carbon, or they could end up on different carbons. Now let's look at propane. We have 3 carbons in a chain. First and last carbon have 3 hydrogens. Middle carbon has 2 hydrogens. If we replace any one of these hydrogens at random with a halogen, there are actually 2 possible products. The halogen might end up bonded to the carbon at the end of the chain, so either left or right carbon, or it could end up bonded to the halogen in the middle of a chain. So this would be 2 possible products. There are 2 groups of equivalent hydrogens here. I have them color-coded, but the hydrogens in blue are all equivalent to each other. I could replace any of these 6 hydrogens and end up with one specific product. The hydrogens in orange are equivalent to each other. I could replace either of these 2 hydrogens and end up with a second product. So think about what this information means in terms of the structure of benzene. The year is now 1865, and I have a challenge for you. Propose a structure for benzene that is consistent with as many observations that I've given as possible. Now, I'm going to be showing you two different structures that were proposed around this point in time. These are the observations that they are actually consistent with. A molecular formula of C6H6, a degree of unsaturation of 4, and 6 equivalent hydrogens. Pause the video now if you want time to think about these structures, because the next thing I'm going to do is show them to you. Here we have two proposed structures of benzene. Let's go through the list of the four things we know about benzene to see how these hold up. First, we know that benzene has a molecular formula of C6H6 and a degree of unsaturation of 4. Both of these fit that criteria. They both have 6 carbons and 6 hydrogens. Let's count their degrees of unsaturation. So a triple bond is a degree of unsaturation of 2. This structure has 2 triple bonds. 2 times 2 is 4. Second structure, there are 3 double bonds plus a ring. That is also a degree of unsaturation of 4. The second thing that we know about benzene is that it's unusually stable, but we don't quite know at this point in time what that looks like in terms of the structure. Third, benzene does not undergo electrophilic addition reactions, and that implies that it does not contain any carbon-carbon double bonds. This first structure, I am seeing 3 carbon-carbon single bonds, 2 carbon-carbon triple bonds, and no double bonds. This looks good. The second structure, I am seeing 3 carbon-carbon double bonds. That looks like a problem. This looks like it should undergo electrophilic addition reactions. The fourth thing that we know about benzene has to do with equivalent hydrogens and the number of products obtained when we start replacing hydrogens with halogens. So if we look at this structure and we were to replace any one hydrogen at random with a halogen, there is only one possible product. All 6 of these hydrogens are equivalent to each other. There is internal symmetry in this molecule in that the left half and the right half are mirror images of each other. However, if I take that product and I replace a second hydrogen with a second halogen, we have 2 possible products. The 2 halogens could be on the same carbon or they could be on different carbons. This is inconsistent with benzene because benzene had 3 products to this second replacement reaction. Now let's look at this structure. If I replace any hydrogen with a halogen, there is only 1 possible product. So that's good. That's consistent with benzene. If I take that product and I replace a second hydrogen with a second halogen, it looks like there would be 4 possible products where benzene only has 3. So I could have the 2 halogens on neighboring carbons, but in 2 different configurations. The neighboring carbons could have a double bond between them or a single bond between them. I could also have the 2 halogens on carbons 1 and 3 or on carbons 1 and 4. So neither of our proposed structures look like they're consistent with benzene. In 1865, the German chemist Friedrich Kekulé proposed that our 2 different 1,2 disubstituted products of benzene are in rapid equilibrium, so we just can't distinguish them or separate them from each other. We are between the years 1865 and 1890. The debate about benzene structure is ongoing. More structures are being proposed. This structure is proposed by Dewar. The main problem with it is that the 6 hydrogens are not equivalent to each other. If we were to replace 1 hydrogen with a halogen, there would be 2 different products. This structure is proposed by Ladenburg. We don't know what gives benzene its unusual stability, but it's not this. This looks unstable. I have a video about Vesper theory in which I was tying balloons together to show molecular geometries. If you have a carbon bonded to 4 different things, the bond angle between the 3 atoms prefers to be 109.5 degrees. When we have 3 carbons in a ring, they are forced to be in an equilateral triangle with 60 degree angles. This is not stable. In fact, there is a molecule called cyclopropane that does have 3 carbons in a ring. It's an explosive. Explosives are not stable. This is not stable. I still have 2 more pieces of the puzzle to give you. We have a hydrogenation reaction from 1901 and X-ray and electron diffraction data from the 1930s. Thanks for watching Chemistry in a Nutshell. If you feel that I've earned it, please like this video and subscribe to my channel.